and we go towards the conservation equation of flow dynamics in order to understand how we describe the flow in this sense concerning the conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, and conservation of energy. A very important theorem is Reynolds transport theorem, because we will always more or less look what is the total change of a physical quantity, like the mass, for example, when we discuss about the conservation of mass. So what we see here, we have a scalar quantity small f, and the capital F would be just the volume integral over small f. So for example, the small f would for us be the density. Okay, so when we are interested in the total change of capital F, which would be the mass, you know, when you integrate over the density, you come up to the mass, then in a so-called Lagrangian system, it is nothing else as you take in the total derivative into the integral, and as you can see, you just take the partial derivative. However, that is the Lagrangian system, and the Lagrangian system is used mainly in structural mechanics, where you as an observer are on the structure, move with the structure. However, for flow dynamics, and it's the same for acoustics, the Eulerian framework makes more sense. So you are somewhere at the fixed position and you look how the flow particles pass and go on. And for this, a total time derivative, as shown here, of any physical quantity, small f, is that you take this partial derivative of small f, integrate over the volume, and we also have to consider what is entering or passing through the surface gamma, which encloses your volume. And as you can see here, the velocity v is coming in, and you have to integrate in this sense then this surface part of v dot n, so the scalar product between the moving you have there in normal direction and your scalar quantity f. Now, from here to here, you can apply the Gauss theorem, sometimes called divergence theorem, where we know that instead of the closed surface integral, you just take the volume integral, but then you have to take instead of your quantity itself the divergence of this quantity. And please take care that this is not only the divergence of the velocity here, it is also the quantity f, which we are interested in for the total change, which has to be taken into this part. Yeah, and that is also in this sense that we have to consider if you have a divergence of a scalar quantity f with a vector field v, then this is, when we apply the product rule, nothing else is the divergence operator operating on the scalar f. It's operating via a gradient scalar product then with the velocity plus f and divergence of the velocity. So you have to apply here clearly, since both quantities depend on the space, you have to apply the classical product rule. So now, to be concrete, as I told you, capital F is now our mass. We are interested in what is the total change of the mass. And we know that the mass we can compute by the volume integral over the density. And what is clearly important in our case is the volume integral, as here explicitly shown, may depend on the time t itself. Yeah, and the conservation of mass is nothing else that it should be zero. Yeah, so the mass we have cannot vanish or increase it. The total change of the mass should be zero, which means we take the total change on our integral quantity, where we integrate over the volume, our density, and now applying this Reynolds transport theorem in an Eulerian framework, it is nothing else as we have here, that it is the partial derivative of this quantity with respect to time, plus the divergence of the density scaled by the velocity and integrating over the whole volume. So what we can see here is that we can now also neglect the volume integral, since this part here has to be zero, and we may write it in the so-called differential form, that the partial change of the density with respect to time plus the divergence of the product of density and velocity is equal to zero. And that is for compressible fluids, and this is the general equation for mass conservation. And this perhaps we first write explicitly, this second term, which we already had here. I just write it now explicitly with the density. And then we see we have the gradient of the density dot product with the velocity plus density divergence of the velocity. Yeah? And if this part is equal to zero, that means we have a constant density. And that is, for example, for an incompressible fluid. And then what remains is just the second part. And that is why we have here the second equation, where we already reduce to incompressible fluids. So the constant density, since the right-hand side is equal to zero, we just have divided by the constant density. And what remains is that the divergence of the velocity is equal to zero. And in order to explicitly show that we model here an incompressible flow, we use this index IC for incompressible. Yeah. So for those coming from electromagnetics, very similar as our magnetic field, where we also force within Maxwell's equation that the divergence of B is equal to zero. Yeah. So I just rewrite it here. So in Maxwell's equation, we have this relation for the magnetic field, B, divergence of B is equal to zero. Yeah? And from physics, we know that when we force that a vector field is equal to zero, then this vector field is a pure solenoidal field. As we call it in German, Wirbelfeld. Yeah? And so you see, we have a very nice relation between incompressible model of flow and the magnetic field itself. Both are then pure solenoidal fields in Fluid dynamics, you call it also vortical. Vortical field. Yeah? And as we know, we can then describe, for example, such a vector field by the curl of a vector potential. And for us, it is the magnetic vector potential. Here, I just write vector potential to indicate this. Yeah? And that is clear because if we compute the divergence of B, which is the divergence of the curl of A, then this is a vector identity and it is always zero. Okay, so we have nicely also the relation to electromagnetics in this case here. One question. When we also want to include sound in our model for the fluid, is it allowed to model the fluid as an incompressible fluid? What do you think? You can write something in the chat or you switch on your microphone. No, yes, you are right. So I just write it on these slides here. So when I write here acoustics, or acoustic, let's write it a little bit more precise. So acoustic waves, then acoustic wave needs a compressible fluid, exactly. Yeah. And that is also what I told you already last time. We now model the flow, and we will see then also when we go towards acoustic by perturbation answers with the ambient density, pressure, velocity, and the fluctuating one, we will come up to the acoustic wave equation. But for this, we need the model of a compressible fluid. If we model the fluid as incompressible, then you can model the fluid, the vortical structures, and so on with this, but no wave propagation. Wave propagation always will need a compressible medium. Okay, yeah, we can clearly also have, instead of a zero, here some value on the right hand side. That would be then some model where we have mass injection or something. So that would be then just a model in order to get your problem at hand better described. But from physics, clearly, if we go towards the general case, then clearly we have that the change, the total change of the mass is equal to zero. Okay, let's go on with the conservation of momentum, which will already be a little bit more complicated. So what is the momentum itself? The momentum itself is the integral of the product of density and velocity. So you can also call this the momentum density then, because it is normalized to the volume. The total momentum is then the volume integral of density multiplied by velocity. And the rate of the change of the momentum has to be balanced, if we have a change there, by forces. Yeah? And so our general equation in this sense is that the forces are equal to the total change of the momentum, which we can express as shown here. So at the end, we will put in here for the momentum the volume integral over density multiplied by velocity. Now let's have a look what forces do we have in a fluid. So in this case, we just look at a cube as shown here, and we have actual two forces we can look for. That is also coming like we have in structural mechanics. We can have forces like the pressure force, yeah, which act in normal direction on a surface, or we can have shear forces, which will come out at the end to be the viscous forces, which act in the tangential plane on such a surface. Yeah? And these are the two typical ones, so we can also rewrite this here, the pressure, and here shear force density, which will come out to be at the end the so-called viscous forces. Okay, so if you consider this in our scripts, you have the full derivation, but I think it's not really necessary for us. Our goal is aeroacoustics, and we should not do all the detailed derivations. In our case, you come up when you consider, in this case, such a cube, and we such a cube here, where we have these two typical forces, the shear forces and normal forces. Normal forces are pressure forces, shear forces will be the viscous forces, and perhaps you consider some volume forces, which could be gravity or electromagnetic forces, which will be at the end for us, we will just set it to zero. Then we have the force term here on the left hand of this equation. And when we apply here the total derivative of the momentum, and we use Reynolds' theorem, transport theorem, we will get out of this part here not only the partial derivative of the time, but also the convective term. And that is already now in the local form that we have a partial derivative of our momentum density, and we have the divergence of this quite complex term which is coming up, which is our again momentum density, and here it is a tensor product with the velocity itself. So this part here is a tensor product between the two vectors. And what do we have on the right hand side? We have the gradient of the pressure. So these are our pressure forces acting on the fluid particles. We have the divergence of a viscous stress tensor. So getting quite complicated. So this is the viscous stress tensor, and we could have here some volume forces, gravity, electromagnetic forces, and so on, which we will more or less neglect. Now, I think you can look up clearly in the appendix how to compute the periodic product between two vectors. However, what I also want to use here is not only this vector notation, I also want to use the index notation. And for the index notation, as we will see, it is easier to really compute these terms. Yeah? We have quite complicated terms here. We have something like a divergence of a tensor of second order, and we have here something which should be at the end also a tensor of second order and take the divergence. What we know when we look at this term here, it is clear we should get out for each of the terms here a vector. Yeah, because what we have here is a vector, what we have here is also a vector, just scaled with the density, which is a scalar function, which means, as we know, the divergence reduces the order of, in general speaking, a tensor. We get out here a tensor of second order, also the viscosity is a tensor of second order, and when you take the divergence, you get out a vector. And that is easier by using the index notation, and the index notation gives you here explicitly written this equation here, where we use the index I and the index j. And now I just want to show you a little bit about this index notation we have here. Yeah, so we have seen this viscous stress tensor Tij. Yeah, so I as well as j can take on the values of x, y, and z in a Cartesian coordinate system, but it's easier to say it's the first direction, second direction, third direction. Yeah, which means that this is like a matrix 3x3, so it is tau 1, 1, yeah, and always the second index will rotate faster and the first index you keep constant. So the first index I will be 1 and j will go from 1 to 3. Yeah? So we have entry tau 1, 1, tau 1, 2, and tau 1, 3. Then we have the entry tau 2, 1. We go over for I to be equal to 2, and j again rotates from 1 to 3. Then we have 2, 2, and 2, 3. And the last line will be tau 3, 1, tau 3, 2, and tau 3, 3. And now it's also easier in this sense when we write down the divergence, and when we write it as a tensor and not the individual entries as written here, we make the square brackets and have this tau here. Yeah? Then it is easier to write it in index notation. Yeah? We have these two indices and we take the spatial derivative with respect to xj. That is what you have seen also here, for example, that we have here a derivative with respect to xj, and we have here this second order tensor, which is like a 3x3 matrix, tau ij. Yeah? And you see, you get out the first equation by fixing I to be 1, and then j going from 1 to 3, and that will give us the first equation. The second equation, we fix I to 2, and again j is going from 1 to 3. And for the third equation, I is equal to 3, and j is going from 1 to 3. Okay, that means now if you do such a derivative, then we will get out a vector, and within the first entry, which is in Cartesian coordinates the x entry, we would have a partial derivative of 1, 1 with respect to x1 plus d tau 1, 2 with respect to x2 plus d tau 1, 3 with respect to x3. The second line gives us when we take on I to be equal to, so it is 2, 1 entry of our viscous tensor with respect to x1 plus tau 2 with respect to x2 plus tau 2,3 with respect to x3. And the last entry of this vector would be tau 3,1, partial derivative with respect to x1, partial derivative of tau 3,2 with respect to x2, plus partial derivative 3,3 with respect to x3. Okay, so you see, that makes sense. And in order perhaps to show you that this also makes sense for a vector itself and not only for tensors of order 2, 3, and so on, if we have, for example, the divergence of a vector u, then this, as you can see here, would be a T u I with respect to xi, yeah, because we have here now just one index, yeah, and that, as we know, gives us du1 dx1 plus du2 dx2 plus du3 dx3, as we are used when we use the classical vector notation. Are there any questions so far? For those who are not familiar with this index notation, I guess it will take some time, but I think, as you can see, well, when you have the divergence of a tensor, please immediately see or immediately compute it, not as easy, perhaps you look up in a mathematical book. But if you use this index notation, yeah, then it is more straightforward. I think then it's easier to get it. And at any time when you have to perform a divergence of a second order tensor, for example, you see, yeah, it is not as complicated as one expects in this case. Okay, so a very important part here is that we also introduce the momentum flux tensor, because this is a combination, as we can see here, of our density Vi, Vj. We have here the pressure with our delta function, yeah, delta Ij, where we know this delta function we can write to be equal 1 for I equal j, and being 0 for the other cases. So you actually make up what we have here, a diagonal tensor of second order or diagonal matrix 3x3, where we have on the diagonal always B and all off diagonals are zero. And we also include there, as you can see here, the viscous part model within our flow. Important quantity is also the stress tensor. And as you can see here, the stress tensor we also have in structural mechanics is decomposed as already explicitly always talked to you by a pressure part . So this is the pressure part, and this is the viscous part. And we know how these forces act. The pressure part acts as a normal force on a surface, and the viscous part acts like a shear force on the surface. Sometimes, and this is without any approximation, we will also use the conservation of momentum in this form here. You call this form actually the non-conservative form of the conservation equation of momentum. So it is the total, it's total the same as written here or in index notation. It's just a reformulation. And you see there are quite some differences. So now you have here this so-called explicitly convective term where you have the velocity dot product with the Nabla operator operating then on the velocity itself and scaled by the density. Here the density is also in front of the partial derivative of the velocity with respect to time. The right hand side is quite similar, but the left hand side is really different in this case. As we again look here, the left hand side here in the conservative form of the momentum equation, we really have the density times the component of the velocity, which is the momentum density here within the partial derivative, and here you have the within the time derivative, and here you have the spatial derivative, and here also this term density Vj Vi is exactly here. Okay, so you see this is the big difference, but they are totally the same. So you can really compute out from one equation the other equation without any simplification. Now, to go in some details concerning the viscosity here, if we assume, and that is for us fully fulfilled, mainly we will look at any flows as a medium, it will be air. And there the viscous stress tensor, again in index notation, it's easier. We can more or less, as you can see, describe by two material parameters, the bulk velocity lambda and the dynamic viscosity mu, as shown here. And you can compute this viscous stress tensor according to this formula, where epsilon, and that is now important, is the so-called strain rate. And the strain rate are the partial derivatives of the velocity with respect to xj as well as with respect to xi. Okay, so in this sense, we have now a model how to get out of the velocity, yeah? Because if we are looking at this equation, not only the velocity is unknown, also the pressure and the viscous tensor here, but we can compute the viscous tensor out of the gradients, so the changes of the velocity with two material parameters, and in a thermodynamic equilibrium, we even can express the lambda as minus 2 over 3 scaled by the dynamic viscosity. So in this case, we just need the dynamic viscosity mu, as you can see here. And with the Stokes hypothesis, you can compute now our viscous stress tensor according to this. So the viscous stress tensor is a very important quantity in fluid dynamics. However, when we will go over to acoustics, it is more or less a term which we neglect. For pure acoustics, we also speak to have wave propagation in a non-viscous medium. So you just set the viscosity to zero. Okay, and the last conservation equation is the conservation of energy. Yeah, it is even a little bit more difficult if you look at all these terms here, this conservation of energy. What else we have here? We have here as new this E. The E is the inner energy or energy density. These are always densities. We have this part here of a thermal source. We have QT I, this is the flux, the thermal flux. Yeah, and the rest is, as we already have introduced, the pressure velocity component and any volume forces. So this would be a heat source density, and this I also can write as a vector is the heat flux. Yeah? And again, if you look here at our vector notation, the equation gets quite involved to compute all these terms. But what is the physical meaning of all these terms? So let's have a look. What we have here is the total change of the energy density, the inner energy density, and the energy density according to the velocity. And this is balanced by all these terms here. And you can see here that we have a first term, which is the heat production per unit volume. Yeah, since this is a QH is a heat source density, the heat conduction energy due to the heat flux, QT, any energy due to the surface pressure forces, yeah, which is given by this term here, or we have it here in index notation. In addition, then we have the energy due to surface shear forces, so this is according to the viscosity you have within your fluid, and any mechanical energy due to some force density, Fi, which could be, for example, the gravity, yeah, which we can in our models at all somehow neglect. We can rewrite the conservation of energy in terms of the entropy also, where the entropy is here is the entropy. So you see what is already included here is now the temperature T, and you see you can rewrite it in this form introducing the entropy. What is for us important is that we mainly can describe the thermodynamic state, and we will see then very simple the conservation of energy in context of acoustics, that we have an adiabatic state, that means our waves are propagating as fast that there we can neglect any heat transfer. Isentropic means it is adiabatic and reversible, which gives us this simplified form of the conservation of energy. And homentropic, which means that then just the total change here of the entropy is equal to zero, or let's say the entropy is just a constant value. And that will be our model towards acoustics. That we can, instead of this quite long equation, which we have it here as a function of the entropy, or here with the inner energy and so on, that we can really make it that this is quite as simple. For all the details, if you are interested, I would say it's getting clearly too complicated, but if you are interested, all the details you find in the script. Do you have any questions concerning all this discussion of the conservation of momentum, mass of energy we just had? Are there any questions or comments? Okay, if this is not the case, then let's go on with our thermodynamic equilibrium in this sense that we get up to the speed of sound C, where in a thermodynamic equilibrium, you can describe it by two intrinsic state variables. Yeah, so you see it, for example, here, the total change of the pressure is a function of density and entropy. So this is the case in a thermodynamic equilibrium, and especially towards acoustic, you always describe your physical quantities by these two intrinsic variables, which is the density rho and the entropy S. And the total change means we have the partial change with respect to the first variable, which is the density at constant entropy, total d rho plus the partial change of the pressure with respect to the entropy at constant density and ds. And as we just have seen in the isotropic case, yeah, if we here go back, our quite complicated conservation of energy equation reduces to the total change of the entropy to be equal to zero. Yeah? Which means that this term here cancels out, and we have a quite nice relation between pressure and density for the isentropic case in a fluid. And that tells us that the total change of the pressure is equal to the total change of the density. And the factor here coming in, C squared, is nothing else as the speed of sound. Okay, speed of sound, perhaps we can look for, it is about 340 meters by second in air. Yeah? So quite a high value compared to standard flow velocity values you have in any flow systems. Now, dimensionless numbers are in fluid dynamics, but also aeroacoustics, very important in order to describe which kind of flow you have, meaning it is more turbulent or even laminar, or you have a high Mach number flow or a low Mach number flow, and so on. So let's start with the first very important dimensionless number. It's the Reynolds number. And within the Reynolds number, we have two, or let's say three main quantities, as you can see here. We need to know from our flow, a characteristic flow velocity, V. Very often this characteristic flow velocity is taken to be the inflow value, then a characteristic length, flow length scale, we call it L, and the kinematic viscosity mu. So this is nothing else, I just write it here, you can compute it by our dynamic viscosity over density. And if this value is large. I don't give you now a correct value because this is really difficult. But if this is large, well, then we know it is more or less a turbulent, with a lot of vertical structures. Or it could be a laminar flow, for low Reynolds numbers. So this is for low Reynolds numbers and for high Reynolds number. You have a very strict value which differs between laminar flow and turbulent flow in a pipe. So if we have a pipe, we have a quite good knowledge about it, and we can say if the Reynolds number is smaller than 2000, we can assume to have a laminar flow, and the turbulent flow would be for a number larger than 2000. Anyway, for any setup, it's not as easy to really differ if it is laminar or turbulent. For us, we will see that turbulent structures, vortices, are really a source of sound, which means directly out of these vertical structures, vortices, we get out sound waves. And therefore, we will see that high Reynolds number flows will generate also quite some part of acoustic waves. A second important dimensionless number is the Mach number. And you see it is quite simple being computed. It's just a ratio of the characteristic velocity in the flow. Again, very often you just take the inflow value over the speed of sound. And again, I write it here that since we mainly will consider any flows being in air, I write here the speed of sound in air, which is about 340 meters per second. It changes a little bit according to the temperature. The Mach number can be the standard, let's say, separation, between a flow being incompressible and compressible is given by the Mach number, and a standard value is if the Mach number is smaller, 0.3, then we can more or less model our flow as incompressible. Remember, incompressible, then the divergence of the flow velocity is equal to zero. We have a constant density, and if this Mach number is larger as 0.3, we can say it's a compressible flow. So we have to take into account the change, the spatial change of the density, and we call then this the compressible flow. Anyway, a flow is always compressible, more or less, but it's the question: can we reduce the complexity a little bit and can model a flow as an incompressible flow? And that will have a big impact on aeroacoustics, on our goal in this course, because when we model a flow as an incompressible flow, then by the computation of such a flow, we neglect any wave propagation. And we can compute then perhaps by a model some sources, and due to the sources, we then can compute the propagation of waves, but we have then the full separation between wave structures and flow structures when we model an incompressible flow, as we just have discussed before, because for wave propagation, you need a compressible fluid, which is then not the case in the model of an incompressible flow. The third very important dimensionless number is the Struhel number. In the introduction, I already have shown you, because with the Struhel number, the flow, for for example, a cylinder in gross flow, the Struhl number for a wide range of Reynolds number is constant, and that helps us, as you can see here, to compute, for example, the frequency f, the shedding frequency generating the vortical structures. And as we there have seen, and you can do by experiments or simulation, that this shedding frequency will be exactly also the frequency you can hear, so which is within the wave propagation. So you see again what we need here to compute it: a characteristic geometric length scale, a characteristic velocity, which we have in the flow. So this characteristic geometric flow value of your flow structure, velocity of your flow, and this is the frequency. Yeah, and written as here, you remember where I have shown you the video and the pictures, this is the shedding frequency, and we can nicely get out the shedding frequency when we know here the Struhl number, which is about 0.1 for a quite large range of Reynolds numbers. Okay, and the last dimensionless number being important for us is the Helmholtz number. The Helmholtz number, however, is already a number we can compute when we know the Struhl number and the Mach number. And this is now already a relation we have between a characteristic length scale of the flow given by L, which we have used in all in the Struhl number as well as in the Reynolds number, and the characteristic length scale of a wave, which is the wavelength. Yeah? And perhaps you know, I just write it down, the wavelength in for acoustics is nothing else as the speed of sound over frequency. The higher the frequency, the smaller the wavelength. And so you have also this relation here. So that, as you can see here, gives you a number out where you see how the structures, how small or how large structures are in the acoustic wave towards the flow field. And very importantly, it will help us, it will come up later on, to describe if your acoustic field is compact or your acoustic sources are compact or not. We call acoustic regions to be compact when the structures there are small compared to the wavelengths. Yeah? So you see the following: if you have a large wavelength, you will have small Helmholtz numbers as shown here. And it is a dimensionless number which already relates the structures in a flow with the structures you have in a wave. Okay, so these are the four dimensional numbers which are very important for us to get the idea about the flow structure and already having a connection to generated acoustic waves. Are there any parts unclear? Do you have any questions up to this part here? Okay, if this is not the case, then let's have some additional physical insight into flow structures. Yeah, so we will introduce here this very important physical quantity in the flow, which is the vorticity. So first of all, let's have an insight how fluid particles move, and you can subdivide it into three different movements, which gives you via superposition then the motion of a fluid particle. So we have translational motion, which we have in a typical potential flow. Yeah? What does potential flow mean? Yeah, we have a very nice relation also to electromagnetics. A potential flow is described by the following sense, that first of all, it is an incompressible flow. Yeah, so we know the flow velocity, the divergence, wanted to write the divergence of the flow velocity is equal to zero. And further on, it's very interesting that you do not have any vertical structures, which means that also the curl of the velocity is equal to zero. Yeah? So this is a very special property of a physical vector field, in our case the flow field, where the divergence and the curl is equal to zero. And in order to fulfill these two equations, what you do is you introduce here, according to this property, that the velocity is equal to minus the gradient of any potential. Yeah. You can also introduce very often, that is the difference between the electrical engineers and the mechanical engineers. The mechanical engineers will not put the minus here. But anyway, you know, if you put a minus or a plus, that's up to you. It will not change anything. The only thing what we know is that the gradient always points towards the increase of the function, and we know the flow goes clearly from a higher potential to a lower potential. That's why sometimes you use the minus, sometimes not. But that is not important in our case. So due to the fact that you express your flow field, vector field, by the gradient of a scalar potential, yeah, and this is the scalar flow potential, you fulfill that the curl of this vector field is equal to zero. And now you just put this into the first equation to also fulfill the first equation. So due to this, when we put it in, this equation then is fulfilled. And so we have to take here this equation and we just put it in, and you see you have the divergence of the gradient of this potential is equal to zero. So this is the describing partial differential equation for a potential flow. You see a potential flow is a source sink field. It is a called also irrotational vector field. Somewhere you have the starting of your vector field, where is the source, and somewhere you have the sink. You do not have closed field lines as you have in a solenoidal vector field, which would be then the case when we go over to not reducing the flow by a potential flow, but taking into account that you have vertical structures and so on. The second motion is the rotation. Yeah? And we will see the rotation of the fluid particles actually will give us the vorticity. And you can have a distortion of the shape, which gives you the strain. In this sense, we already have introduced our strain tensor. When you remember describing in this sense the viscosity tensor, and the rate of the strain, which we call epsilon, which is a tensor of second order. Now you see this is something like the gradient of a vector. Yeah, so you could also write this the gradient of V. Don't put the scalar product in between, because then it would be the divergence of this vector, but it is the gradient. And again, how to compute the gradient of a vector? It's quite easier to write it in index notation. Yeah, so you see it is the partial derivative of the I component of this vector with respect to xj. Again, you first will set I to 1 and j is going to 1 to 3, and you get the first line in your 3 by 3 matrix, which is a tensor of second order. And then you fix I equal to 2 and j is going from 1 to 3 and so on. Now you get here a matrix or a tensor of second order, which is clearly not symmetric, but you can decompose such a tensor in a symmetric part. Yeah, so this is then symmetric, and into a non-symmetric part. And now we can go back to the motion of the fluid particles. So we can associate that the translational motion we have in a pure potential flow, the rotation, which is for us at the end also the vorticity, is described by the antisymmetric part, and the distortion of the shape of your fluid particles is described by the symmetric part. And if you look to this non-symmetric part we have here, then you will see, if you explicitly write it down, that this part can be rewritten, yeah, by the curl of the velocity. So the vorticity is given by the curl of the velocity, and it will describe us the vertical structure of a flow. And as we will see later on, since there is some theory on for vorticity sound, that this vorticity is actually a very good model, because we can show that out of each individual vertical structure we get a radiation of sound. Okay, so in this sense, what we also can already look here is the following. The vorticity itself is the curl of a velocity. Now, if we go here and make some investigation, and we have here V as our velocity field, then according to Helmholtz, we can decompose each vector field into a irrotational part, which we can describe by a scalar potential, and a solenoidal part, which we can describe by a vector potential. What's going on here? Okay, now writing this as formulas, we have then the following that we can write V to be the curl of any vector potential, let's call it A, plus a gradient of any scalar potential, let's call it psi. Yeah, so this is our vertical part or solenoidal part. And this is, we call it the longitudinal part. Or irrotational. And if you look now at the vorticity, which is the curl of V, and we use this decomposition of our vector field in the irrotational part and in the solenoidal part, it's the curl of A, plus the curl of the gradient of psi. However, this is always equal to zero. The curl of a gradient is always zero. So you see this vertical part or this vorticity is just described by the vertical part of the flow field. So this is a very important information which we will use quite often in the next time. So the vertical structures of the flow are always described by a base flow, let's call it, which is a incompressible flow. Okay, now in this sense, the field lines of our vorticity field are always tangential to the vorticity vector. They are closed field lines. That is what we also know from electromagnetics for the magnetic field lines. And you have this general relation that when you take the divergence and integrate over the volume according to the divergence theorem, it's the same as integrating over a closed surface. The vorticity itself, that this is always equal to zero. Yeah, and that is, as you also know from electromagnetics, for the magnetic field itself, where the divergence of B is equal zero. If you take a closed surface integral over this vector field, then this is clearly always zero. And due to some rearrangements, you can compute out also the Crocus form of the momentum conservation, where you see that the vorticity pops up and a new quantity, which is the total enthalpy. Yeah? And for homentropic flows, which we mainly consider, it is, as you see here, the integral over 1 over density integration dp, p being the pressure, plus 1/2 velocity squared, which we know is direct proportional to the kinetic energy. So this is the total enthalpy. And we also introduce here an interesting quantity, which is the lump vector being the cross product between vorticity and velocity. That will also come up later on in some of our aeroacoustic models, where we will see that the divergence of this lump vector is also a good source model to get the acoustic sources out of the flow and be able then to compute the propagation of sound. And if we look here now, We can rewrite this Broca's equation. Details you find in the script, but I think that is, it's good if you do this rearrangement of equations. But what is important here is that you can rewrite the total change then by two terms. Yeah? And you can see the first term is a dot product between our vorticity and the gradient, the incompressible flow, and the second term is the Laplacian on this vorticity scaled by our viscosity nu. Now let's look at the first term. Yeah? So the total change of our vorticity is given due to these two terms. So what is actually the first term from the physical point of view, and what is the second term? So the first term would be, in this case, that we have more or less no viscosity in the flow, then this term would vanish, and we just have the relation that the total change of our vorticity is given by this term. That means that our vortex lines being given up by the particles, that they are rotated and stretched according to the flow. Yeah? Because we have here the vorticity dot product gradient of the incompressible flow. And that means when vortex tubes are stretched, the cross-sectional area is increased or decreased. And if it is decreased, then this just can't be the case when that the amplitude of the vorticity is increased. On the other hand, when the second term is of importance, yeah, so which is the Laplacian of the vorticity scaled by the viscosity, then this is in the flow just in regions where you have high shear. And where do you have high shear? It's clear when you have a flow through a pipe or a flow over a plate, we know that on the surface of the plate or on the surface of the pipe, the inner surface of the pipe, the velocity sticks on it. The velocity is directly zero, which means near the walls, you will have a region of high shear. And that is just explained by a plate or a pipe that is particular near boundaries. And there the equation reduces to a diffusion equation, yeah? Because we neglect here our first term. And that is an equation describing how vortical structures are generated. Yeah? And they are generated at solid boundaries. If you perhaps remember, we had this cylinder in cross section and this shading of the vortical structures we have exactly on the surface of the cylinder itself, and the vertical structures are shaded there and go downstream. So the vorticity is generated at solid boundaries, and we can interpret that the viscosity is responsible for its diffusion into the fluid domain. So we see that both parts are important. However, there's especially this part we have here with the viscosity is just dominated near solid boundaries. Somewhere in the regions we have where the flow is and we have there no solid boundaries, we even can neglect this term. But in order that such vertical structures are generated, it's important to take this part into account, and that part is near solid boundaries. Okay, so incompressible flow without the vorticity, yeah, we already have discussed, and that is the potential flow. Yeah, that is now just written here. It is a flow which is divergence and curl free. The divergence of the velocity is equal to zero. Also, the curl is zero. In order that the curl is zero, we introduce a scalar potential, as we have called it here, phi, and you have a Laplacian equation to describe here the potential. Now, if we have an incompressible flow with vorticity, we can apply there the Helmholtz decomposition as shown here and describe it by the curl of a vector potential. For example, here, the incompressible part is always described by a vector potential. And we also introduce here, as I have already quite often used, this V means vertical. Yeah? It's the vertical part of the overall flow field. For the Helmholtz decomposition, we then have, in addition to describing the vertical part by a vector potential, we have the gradient of a scalar potential. However, if we take the curl of such an incompressible flow, which we have now described by a scalar potential and a vector potential, yeah, remember, this part must somehow associate to the potential flow within an incompressible flow with vorticity being different from zero. And the vorticity must be described by the curl of the vector potential. If we take the curl, clearly the gradient of the scalar potential cancels out, and we know taking the curl gives us the vorticity, and that is purely described by the vertical part of the flow. And that can associate to the incompressible part of a general flow velocity. Now, by taking the Laplacian, so this curl-curl of the vector potential being equal to the vorticity, so this is now our equation, can be described also by the vector Laplacian of psi equal minus the vorticity when we take into account that the divergence of this vector potential psi is equal to zero. Using Green's functions, you get then out, and that is a very important thing, that the vertical part goes to zero with the order of 1 over distance to the third. Yeah? So this is quite interesting, not easy to prove. You can find it in the script. However, that is important. So the vertical structures decay very strongly, yeah, extreme strongly. And that is quite different to the longitudinal part, which describes waves, as we will see in the next lecture of this course. So that should now be important information for us, that these vertical structures decay quite strongly because it decays by the order of 1 over the distance to the third. Yeah? And we will actually later on see that our wave structures will decay by 1 over the distance. Yeah? And that is also a nice relation where we then can, at least by the distance, separate between the flow structures, being the vortical structures, and the acoustic structures, which are characterized by the wave propagation. Okay, so I think today we have discussed quite a lot of new things for you in order to describe the flow. We have a lot of equations. I don't expect that you know and remember all these equations. For me, it is important that you get some ideas how the flow is described, and that especially our flow field includes vortical structures, longitudinal structures. Yeah, and we know in order that we can also describe wave propagation, we need a compressible flow. And we have seen that actually we can decompose such a compressible flow in pure vortical structures, which are characterized by the vorticity. And these vortical structures decay quite strongly by 1/distance to the power of 3. However, these compressible structures we have there, which also describe wave propagation, that these parts, yeah, they just have a decay of 1/distance, and that has to be within the compressible part. Although we will also see that not the whole part of the compressible flow structures, yeah, when we subtract there the vertical parts, are waves. Just some part of this compressible flow will be converted into the radiation of waves. But that we will discuss in more detail next time, and we will have a base then concerning the flow, and we'll go over to acoustics, and we'll then very nicely see all the relations between the flow structures and the acoustic structures.